it being the conclusion, it's kind of sad, but it's been an exciting ride. It is part of the time. Sometimes I'll go to the library and jot down notes as I get ideas. You know, sometimes I'll think about it at night before I go to bed. I just want solitude. I want quiet places where I can sit. There are times I've taken vacation from work, and that's all I did was work on my novel. I put the old laptop here on the table and just wrote away. I do. Right now, I'm really into authors like Tom Wolfe and John Updike. Books like that. Oh yes, I do. I do. Read like crazy. And like I said before, pay attention to what you're reading. Pay attention to the way an author shapes a story. Take notes. I do. As I walk and I read, I take notes in every book. But at the same time, enjoy what you're reading. Read lots of different authors. Pay attention to the mechanics. Learn how to use a comma. This is from part two, Donnie Bleeds. What the hell's going on? Bogey asks, pulling his arm out of Rachel's grip and doubling his fists. The rest of the light in the sky had shrunk to a sickly yellow over the mountains, then to nothing, leaving behind an unfriendly cold that worked its way into the fabric of Rachel's jeans and jacket. Only where she pressed against Jeff did any warmth stay behind. She squeezed her eyes shut and found guilty comfort in the way his hand touched her back, and how the smell of Polo cologne, the same cologne Bogey wore, mixed with the scent of detergent, sweat, and cigarettes. "Somebody's up there," Bogey said. Rachel opened her eyes, unable to see if he'd noticed Jeff holding her, and whether he cared or not. This new thought had a strange, enticing quality to it, so contrary to her loyal nature that it surprised her, but yet it felt almost irresistible. Images of Bogey fighting for her stirred feelings she hadn't been aware of before, thrilling feelings, masking her fear with a sense of power and desire. The urge to passionately kiss Jeff began to glow deep under her belly and spread until her heart pounded and her breath shortened. She turned her head and could feel his breath near her cheek. Desire grew and filled her mind with fog. All he had to do was turn his head a little, and her lips would be soft and loosened and puckered for the taking. Huh, to hell with Bogey. Her eyes flickered in his direction as he walked away, a black outline against a darker black. And she almost begged him to turn around so he could see what she was about to do. But then she became aware of something else, like a rotten aftertaste, as it glided under her temptations. Something foreign, dangerous, electrical, and part of the darkness around her, influencing her. She shrank from it and asked herself, after all Bogey had done, did he deserve to be hurt like that? Maybe he did. Maybe he didn't. An object in Bogey's hand glinted, barely catching a fleeting splash of moon glow. Rachel remembered the knife he always carried with him. Bogey tended to brag a lot, but the knife he mostly kept mum about, even to her. Jeff gripped her shoulders, and though she protested, she felt it gently push her away. "Bogey," Jeff said. The strange noise disappeared, and in its place came a settling. As the breeze died away, more terrible visions entered her mind, and she struggled to reason that it might simply be her imagination gone wild. Bogey in a pool of blood, his eyes torn out. A greasy, sweaty cliff raging over her like a beast. Holding a baby and looking down into its tenebrous, demonic eyes. Distorted figures looming off the side of the road, just at the edge of her vision. Voices in the breeze. Rachel desperately fought to hold on to Jeff's arm. "Athola." "Jeff, tell me you just said that," Rachel said. "Shh!" He hushed her and pulled away from her grip. "Bogey!" "Shut up!" Bogey said in a strained whisper. "Don't go up there," Rachel said. "Oh my gosh!" More things moved in the trees and rustled the brush, the sounds unmistakably distinct, stalking sounds, surrounding sounds. Rachel pulled from her pocket the lighter Bogey had tossed her. With a shaking hand, she managed to make sparks, but no flame. "Jeff, please." "Hold on," he said. And she felt the distance widening between them in the darkness. Flick, flick, flick. The sparks blinded and frustrated her. While Jeff proceeded, she stopped to steady her hand. One flash, then another, then a low bubble of flame, a low blue bubble of flame. Her thumb began to feel raw against the tiny wheel as it ground the flint. The flame went out and she swore. She blinked at the blind spots created by the sparks, and she thought she saw things move from the darkness on the road in front of her. Her breath shook. "Oh my gosh, oh my gosh." She felt around the hot top of the lighter for the tiny switch that controlled the butane flow. It caught against the tip of her fingernail and moved. The next spark brought a smooth, tall flame. The view expanded into a circle of light, revealing gravel, weeds, intruding tree branches, and a pair of green glowing eyes in the road where she thought Jeff